Hi, let's talk about the renal vasculature. In this video, we'll discuss the flow of blood to and through the kidney, as well as the peculiarities of the tributaries of the left renal vein and how that relates to left renal vein entrapment syndrome. So first of all, kidneys are supplied by renal arteries. They're frequently, about a third of the time, also supplied by accessory renal arteries, but for the time being, let's ignore those. So a renal artery is typically going to multifurcate into five segmental arteries. We call them segmental arteries because they supply renal segments. So there is an apical renal segment, an inferior renal segment, an anterior superior renal segment, an anterior inferior renal segment, and then posterior or deep to these, but corresponding with their relative positions, as I'll outline here. There's also a posterior segment as well. Now, these segmental arteries are end arteries, meaning they don't anastomose or share blood in anyway, so there is no open anastomosis typically, nor are there overlaps of capillary beds. So each segment has its own dedicated arterial supply, which allows for the removal of that segment. We would call that a partial nephrectomy without affecting the other remaining segments. It probably also bears relating. Much like in the lungs, where we have an analogous system, the intrarenal veins do typically anastomose. So arteries won't cross from segment to segment, but veins may. As we move forward, it probably would be useful to also define what a renal lobe and lobule are. A renal lobe consists of a renal pyramid as well as all of the cortex surrounding that pyramid. So half a column as well as the entire cortical arch here. A lobule is a way of subdividing the lobe, and a lobule consists of all of the cortex. Here, this would be a cortical arch surrounding a single medullary. We're in line with a single medullary ray. So that's roughly going to be between these vessels here. These are called the cortical radiate arteries, also known as the interlobular arteries. These are helpful as we describe the nomenclature of subsequent branches of the segmental arteries. So let's walk through that, and we'll just follow any old segmental artery. Let's follow this one here, serving the apical segment. So coming off of segmental arteries are interlobar arteries. So we can see there's an interlobar artery there, there's an interlobar artery there, and there. These interlobar arteries are going to enter into the parenchyma in the regions dividing the cortical arch from the medulla. So there's the pyramid of the medulla, here's the cortical arch, and they will ascend between those two tissues. And as they ascend, they will branch off cortical radiate arteries. These arteries radiate out into the cortex. They're also known as interlobular arteries because they're also defining lobules. Now, as an interlobar artery rounds the bend from the lateral side of a pyramid here to the base of the pyramid, it becomes known as an arcuate artery. So if it's on the side of the pyramid, it's an interlobar artery, and if it's on the base of the pyramid, it is an arcuate artery. Arcuate arteries much like interlobar arteries, also give off cortical radiate arteries. These cortical radiate arteries are then going to supply afferent arterioles, which supply the glomeruli. Those are the specialized capillary beds that are part of the renal corpuscles, where we have glomerular filtration, or the movement of materials from the cardiovascular system into the nephron. From there, blood is going to travel through efferent arterioles, and these efferent arterioles are going to supply both paratubular capillaries as well as vasorecta. These vasorecta are specialized vessels within juxtamedullary nephrons. And then we'll have a similar drainage pattern. So there will be paratubular venules going into cortical radiate veins, into arcuate veins, into interlobar veins, and then finally into renal veins. Now, as we move to more granular levels, so here we have the arcuate artery. That arcuate artery is giving off a cortical radiate artery. And here we can see afferent arterioles going out to supply the glomeruli here as part of the renal corpuscle. And then coming off of that glomerulus will be the efferent arteriole. Now this is interesting because glomeruli are capillary beds and efferent arterioles supply paratubular capillaries. So we have a capillary bed connected to a capillary bed by a vessel. Anytime that we have that situation, it's called a portal system. And so this is the basis of the renal portal system. These paratubular capillaries, which are surrounding the nephron tubes, are going to be involved with the processes of tubular secretion and tubular reabsorption. The vasorecta are specialized vessels that are going to be basically elaborations of paratubular capillaries surrounding the nephron loops of juxtamedullary nephrons. And so these are going to be involved in moving water out of the medulla to create a hyperosmotic gradient within the medulla, so to continue to pull water out from the nephron loop. So paratubular veins are then going to feed into cortical radiate veins, which will feed into arcuate veins, which are going to mirror the various hierarchy of the arteries as they supplied the nephrons. In terms of what we could expect to see in lab, much of what I just discussed can only be seen on a microscopic level with the help of a light microscope or other imaging techniques. But reliably, we will be able to see renal arteries. We will reliably be able to see segmental arteries and interlobar arteries. Reliably also, and this is going to depend on a dissection, we can see arcuate arteries. And of course, if accessory renal arteries are present, we can oftentimes see them. So about a third of the time, accessory renal arteries will be present. If they're present going into the hilum, they'll be known as hilar arteries. If they are associated with either the superior or the inferior poles, they'll be known as polar arteries. So anything cortical, radiate, and beyond will not be visible in the laboratory. So if you don't see it, don't have your feelings hurt, and I wouldn't waste much time looking for it, because without special technology, you're not going to be able to view them. On the other side of things is the venous return. And we have a really interesting situation here, but let's kind of get the lay of the land within that retroperitoneal space. So here is the inferior vena cava. The inferior vena cava, the IVC, is sort of the clearinghouse of the return of blood from the lower limbs, the pelvis, and the abdomen. And so there are various tributaries to it. So here we can see the right renal vein. Here we can see the left renal vein. And we can get a sense that the left renal vein is significantly longer than the right renal vein. It's about 3 times longer than the right renal vein. Here's the abdominal aorta coming down, and it will have various branches, as we'll see. This major branch here is known as the superior mesenteric artery, or the SMA for short. And we can see that that SMA has a unique relationship with the left renal vein here. So that left renal vein is going to be found between the SMA and the abdominal aorta, and that's going to be significant. But let's go back to veins here. On the left side, structures on the left are further from the inferior vena cava than their counterparts on the right. And what we'll see are left inferior phrenic veins, oftentimes combining with left suprarenal veins, and there's a common trunk here, draining into the left renal vein. We'll also have left gonadal veins draining into the left renal vein. And all of these structures, so the left hemidiaphragm, the inferior surface of the hemidiaphragm, the left suprarenal gland, and the left gonad, on the right side, their respective veins drain directly into the IVC. But on the left side, they drain into the left renal vein, which is, again, located between the SMA and the abdominal aorta. So let's go back to... Here's our abdominal aorta. Looking at this in profile, here's the SMA, and then between the two of these, we have the left renal vein. If there is an aneurysm, such as an abdominal aortic aneurysm, a AAA here, that can squeeze that left renal vein and oftentimes occlude the return of blood from the regions drained by the left renal vein. So the left kidney, the left inferior surface of the hemidiaphragm, the left suprarenal gland, and the left gonad. So that's going to be problematic. You know, it likely is going to present as hematuria, that's blood in the urine, flank or gonadal pain, and varicocele, which is the expansion of the plexus of veins surrounding the scrotum. And this condition is sometimes referred to as nutcracker syndrome, not because of the left gonadal pain, but because of the resemblance of the SMA and abdominal aorta to a nutcracker. But oftentimes this is mistaken by the lesser minds, which sometimes the lesser personalities haunt us all. So don't feel ashamed there, but do have an appropriate amount of decorum, professionalism, and empathy for patients. So we've discussed the flow of blood from the renal arteries to and through the kidneys out to the renal veins, as well as the peculiarities of the left renal vein tributaries. This is your summary slide. Thank you for your time.